one of our connections with Allah, that bond with Allah, we pray to Allah, we put our hope in Allah, what Allah gives us from Him is that glue that holds our heart together and keeps it from being shattered. He gives us that strength. This is actually what I wanted to talk to you about from the ayah of Surah Fussilat. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَ اللَّهِ. No doubt about it, those who declared our master is Allah. Seems like a pretty simple statement. Our master is Allah. It's not a simple statement. You're not just saying our creator is Allah, or the one we worship is Allah. You're calling Him your Rabb. Our Rabb is Allah. Rabb is a mun'im. Rabb is someone who does favors for you you don't deserve, and keeps giving you what you don't deserve. That's the first meaning of Rabb. So Allah is one for us who will give me more than I deserve. And He will keep giving me more than I deserve. And He will keep making... And mun'im also means the one who gives in'am, meaning the one who makes things easy. He's the one who's going to keep making things easy for me. That's who He is to me. I've declared that when I called Him Rabb. Al-mun'im. Wal-murabbi. He's the one who is going to make sure that I continue to grow, that I continue to progress, that I'm not going to stay in place. If I'm in a problem, He's going to allow me to grow out of that problem. If I'm in a state of weakness, He will give me the strength, like a plant grows and turns, like a little blade turns into a tree, He'll give me the strength to become, to navigate and to be able to overcome the weakness that I have. This is al-murabbi. Wal-qayyim, the one who's going to make sure I don't fall apart. Just because you're ensuring something is growing doesn't mean you're not taking care of the problem. You know, you can build a building and you're building more and more floors, but the foundation's falling apart. The whole thing's going to collapse. Allah will hold me in place, take care of me and not let me collapse. He's my Rabb. Wal-qayyim, was-sayyid, and He is in charge. He's in charge of what I do. He's taken total authority over me. I'm not in charge anymore. You know, again, maybe imagery will help you understand this. If you are bad at swimming, and you find yourself in the middle of the ocean, and you're splashing and doing whatever you can, and nothing's helping. Water keeps going up your nose and in your mouth, and nothing seems to be helping, and you're getting exhausted. And until you realize there's someone holding you from underneath, you just need to relax and just let go. And He's just keeping you floating. He's not going to let you drown. When you let go, that's actually Rabbun Allah. Our master is Allah. Whatever struggle, storm I'm going through, He's not going to let me drown. He's holding me in place. Those who openly declare that, they acknowledge that they are not in control of their situation. They acknowledge that they cannot control other people's opinions. They acknowledge they cannot control what any of the creation of Allah does. When anybody else, and you know, some of you spend your days and nights thinking about how this person is going to harm me. What are they going to say? What are they going to do? What are they going to think? This is what's going on in your head all the time. You're preoccupied with it. And when you accept Rabbun Allah, you let that go. Because the one who's protecting you, and the one who's keeping you in place, and the one who's going to navigate you through the storm, you've declared, you've handed it over to Him. You've let go. Rabbun Allah. And that declaration is so powerful, it's a kind of freedom. There are so many of us who make so many decisions in our life. As a matter of fact, so many of our emotions in our life are controlled by other people. They're controlled by other people. How sad you are, how angry you are, how hurt you are. We're letting other people control how we feel. And when you really truly declare, my master is Allah, the power creation has over you disappears. Like they're just creations. They have no power when Allah doesn't give them that power. And when He strengthens your heart, then whatever they have to say and do bounces right off of you. And it doesn't hurt you anymore. Again, reality doesn't change. You change. You change. I'll give you another quick example of that. You know, there was a terrible slander that the ayat I was sharing with you previously, I'll come back to that series soon. The ayat I was sharing with you about the slander against Aisha radiallahu anha. Ayat came of the Quran. Ayat came of the Quran and she felt relieved. She felt relieved. But you know what? The hypocrites were still hypocrites. The filthy mouth was still a filthy mouth. People were still saying what they were saying. That didn't change. For the believers, they recognized it and they took made tawbah and they changed. But for people who had dirt in their hearts, they didn't change. So the hurtful words and the hurtful slander and the hurtful accusations continued. As a matter of fact, they continue until this day. They continue until today. And yet she's relieved. reality didn't change. Allah didn't send those ayat to silence everybody. Because that's not going to happen. Allah doesn't do things that way. They let them dig their grave. That's fine. Allah sent those ayat so those who believe can have strength, their heart could be tied. Their heart could find peace. That's actually, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَ اللَّهِ. Then he says, ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا. They didn't just say, our master is Allah. Then they lived a life of trying to stand up straight. They lived a life of holding on to رَبُّنَ اللَّهِ. Not letting anybody else pull them down. Not letting anybody else get control. Not letting anybody else become their owner. Not emotionally, not physically, not financially, not in terms of their temptations. They recognized Allah's supreme authority and control and care over them. And they reminded themselves of that over and over again. You know, istaqama in Arabic doesn't just mean to be straight. They use it for poetry. Istaqama shi'ar, ittazana. Aw azala ibajahu. Like when the poet used to write a poem, it didn't totally rhyme. So he would make adjustments to fix it. Until it's finally even, all the rhymes are even, and all the lines are even, all the syllables line up. That's the idea of istiqama. In other words, you don't just say, my master is Allah, and now you're perfect. No, you keep struggling to fix yourself. You find yourself leaning this way, a little too much fear in your life, and you pull yourself together. And you don't let that fear overwhelm you. You find too much sadness in your life, and you remind yourself of Allah, and you hold on to Allah again, and He pulls you back together again. The idea of holding on to Allah to overcome and to be able to navigate your grief and your sadness. Again, I remind you, as I said in the beginning, our faith in Allah will not get rid of our grief. And our faith in Allah will not get rid of our sadness and will not get rid of our fear. But it will make us strong enough to overcome them. Strong enough to go through them without breaking us. It is in those moments of fear and of sadness and of grief, that is when shaitan comes and wants you to let go of Allah. Because shaitan feeds you something else. Shaitan says, if Allah is so great, why are you upset? If Allah is so awesome, why did you have to go through all this sadness? Allah could have just gotten rid of your sadness. He could have created a situation where you had to experience no sadness. Why did you have to go through it? Why do you have to have these fears? Why do you deserve this anxiety? Let go of Allah. He's not doing anything for you. That's shaitan's most powerful opportunity in those moments. In those moments. And yet Allah here says, if you can hold, not only declare that your master is Allah, but you can hold on to that deep inside you, not from someone else, for yourself. If you can do that, then what does He say? تَتَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ أَلَّا تَخَافُ وَلَا تَحْزَنُ وَأَبْشِرُوا بِالْجَنَّةِ. If people can live a life of doing that, and holding on to Allah that way, then as they're dying, as they're leaving this world, people around them are crying. They can't even speak anymore. They're on their deathbed. And yet, they can see what their relatives can't see. They can see angels come down. And angels are having a conversation with a person on their deathbed. And they're telling him or her, you don't have to fear anymore. There's no more fear at all. And there's no more sadness at all. Congratulations, you're going to heaven. وَأَبْشِرُوا بِالْجَنَّةِ الَّتِي كُنْتُمْ تُوَعَدُونَ. And then they add something. This is at the end of their life. They're not even in their grave yet. They're not even in their grave yet, and yet they're being told you're going to heaven by angels. Everybody else is crying, they're the ones smiling inside. Everybody thinks, oh, this is so sad, this is such a tragedy, and this is the greatest moment of their life. This is the greatest moment because they lived that. They navigated that storm. When they're in that moment, what do the angels tell them? They tell them, نَحْنُ أَوْلِيَاؤُكُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ. We were your guardian angels. We were protecting you in this life and we will also in the next life. Allah sent us a special security team just for you. When you were being overwhelmed and you held on to Allah, we became your security around your heart. When you were overwhelmed with grief and sadness and fear, we were the ones that Allah used to send for you. We were the ones that guarded you. We were the ones that shielded you from the whispers of the devil. We were there all along. They're introducing themselves to you. You're meeting them for the first time. They've known you your whole life. نَحْنُ أَوْلِيَاؤُكُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ يَا رَبِّ. That's the promise of Allah to those who hold on to Him.